Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 15206 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a Stage 3 timetable for the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Targets Scotland Bill. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 15206 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is Stage 3 proceedings on the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Targets Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is Scottish Parliament Bill 51A, the marshalled list and the groupings of amendments. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for around 5 minutes for the first division of the Stage 3. The period of voting for the first division will be 45 seconds. Thereafter, I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after a debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press their request to speak buttons or enter RTS in the chat as soon as possible after I call the group. Members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments. We go to Group 1, Setting Scottish Carbon Budgets Scrutiny Procedure. I call Amendment 1 in the name of Monica Lennon, grouped with Amendments 2 and 5. Monica Lennon to move Amendment 1 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move Amendment 1 in my name and I'll speak to the other two amendments in this group. At Stage 2, Scottish Labour felt it was important to amend the bill to require the Scottish Government to act in accordance with the advice that it received from the Climate Change Committee. And for that reason, I brought forward 4 amendments to achieve that aim, and these were approved at committee at Stage 2. However, after Stage 2 was complete, I then discussed with the Scottish Government whether that was indeed the best approach, and we very helpfully had a swift letter from the Climate Change Committee who'd been clearly paying attention. And the Climate Change Committee, I think, helpfully explained it's not their intention to set policy for this Parliament or for Government, and it's important they maintain their role as an advisory body. So Scottish Labour reflected on that position and we agree with that. So I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for meeting with me and Sarah Boyack last week to try and find a form of words that would achieve a compromise, but still trying to strengthen the bill, which I think across the Parliament is what we've all wanted all along. So the effective Amendment 1 is quite simple. It deletes that part of the Stage 2 amendment that talks about taking, I've lost my train of thought here. I've got too many scribbles on my sheet of paper. In accordance with, which really was binding the Scottish Government to take the advice, and instead to take into account the most up-to-date advice that they have received from the relevant body. In this case, we're talking about the Climate Change Committee. So I hope that that makes sense to colleagues, and I'm grateful to the Government for their cooperation on that. In terms of the other 2 amendments in the group, not really much to say there, but we believe that Amendment 2 in the Cabinet Secretary's name is necessary because at Stage 2, an amendment passed that referenced provisions in another amendment from Mark Ruskell that was ultimately not passed at Stage 2. So this is an attempt to simplify that and tidy that up. Amendment 5 in the name of Mark Ruskell aims to provide a super affirmative procedure for carbon budget regulations, which Mark Ruskell raised at Stage 2. However, at Stage 2, I worked with the Cabinet Secretary to introduce a pre-laying procedure for future carbon budgets, mirroring procedures already in law in the 2009 Climate Change Act. I understand Mark Ruskell's aims and we support the principle behind that, but we feel in practice the bill amended at stage two provides a sufficient balance between scrutiny and timely action due to the new procedure that was under part A5. So we won't be able to support Mark Ruskell's amendment.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, to speak to Amendment 2 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to begin today in the spirit of collegiality that's been a feature of the progression of this bill. So let me start by thanking everyone who's taken up my offer of having an open door to hearing what they want from the bill and engaging with me and working together to achieve consensus. And this was shown ahead of Stage 2 and again over the past week ahead of Stage 3. And I'm pleased that there is agreement with the other parties on the vast majority of the amendments today. I've worked with Monica Lennon on Amendment 1 in this group. I hope it will be supported by all today. I understood Ms Lennon's desire at Stage 2 to ensure the UK Climate Change Committee's advice is given proper respect when we set our carbon budgets, but the CCC itself, as Ms Lennon says, has written to make clear that it does not want to be put in the position of determining rather than advising elected representatives what levels to set carbon budgets at. So I'm very grateful to Monica Lennon for her willingness to work with me and my officials to find a balanced amendment that emphasises the crucial role of the CCC without placing that panel of experts in an uncomfortable position. The phrasing of Amendment 1 aligns the language in this section to the equivalent one in the UK, Welsh and Northern Irish legislation. It emphasises the importance of the CCC's advice while allowing the final decisions to be made by the Scottish Parliament, thus ensuring democratic accountability. It's a sensible and balanced approach, and I urge members to support it. Now to Amendments 2 and 5. Amendment 2 in my name and Amendment 5 in Mark Ruskell's are alternatives to one another, and I urge members to support Amendment 2 and not to agree to Amendment 5. At Stage 2, there were alternative amendments providing for enhanced scrutiny of carbon budget setting regulations after the first regulations. I supported Monica Lennon's amendment, as does the committee, and it means that budget setting regulations will be subject to the robust enhanced scrutiny process already set out in Section 97 of the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009 for other types of regulations under the Act. And I think it is the right additional scrutiny process for budget setting regulations. The other amendments on the subject were a pair from Mark Ruskell, and confusingly one of the pair was agreed to but the other was not, leaving the bill cross-referring to Section A4A, and which does not exist. So my Amendment 2 is a tidying up amendment to remove what is now an erroneous reference. Amendment 5 from Mark Ruskell is basically the same as the amendment that the committee did not agree to at Stage 2 and again seeks to insert Section A4A that's cross-referred to.
Yes. Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way? I was just wondering if she could confirm then that what was put forward and agreed by the committee of Monica Lennon's amendment at Stage 2 effectively is a super-affirmative process now, and it will follow that sort of pre-laying procedure that we have in the climate bill already.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think as a result of the amendment I've put forward, it's more of a tidying up exercise because of the two amendments, one did not get passed, but the other one effectively took the will of the committee forward. So it really is just a tidying up exercise on my part. Like the committee at Stage 2, I do not support inserting Section A4A because the bill is at immersion of Stage 2 is in the right place when it comes to enhanced scrutiny. So hopefully that answers Mark Ruskell's point there. As the bill stands now, Section 97 of the 2009 Act will require engagement before draft regulations are laid for the approval for the Parliament on a wider and more thorough ongoing basis than Section A4A would do. I think I'll actually leave it there, Presiding Officer, because I've pretty much gone through all my comments in regard to those amendments.
Thank you. I call Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 5 and other amendments in the group.
Yeah, thanks very much, Presiding Officer. Obviously, we're all agreed that on the importance of scrutiny of the carbon budgets and committees having enough time to do that. And I think we're all agreed on the fact that this would ordinarily be important to go through a super affirmative procedure. Obviously, there's a rush to get this first carbon budget approved, but ordinarily committees would be taking time to bring in evidence and time to consider whether the budget is adequate or not. At Stage 2, I moved effectively a super affirmative process into the bill, which would have enabled committees to consider for 120 days a carbon budget that was pre-laid. I think Monica Lennon, that's now been clarified, moved forward a slightly different amendment, which would require, which would enable committees to take 90 days to consider the carbon budget. So I'm content with where we've got to. I think we've had a clarification from the Cabinet Secretary. I won't be moving five. I'll be accepting the Cabinet Secretary's Amendment 2 just to tidy up where we've got to at stage 3. And just on Amendment 1, I mean, I do accept that UKCCC is an advisory body, but it's not this Parliament. It's not this elected Parliament, and this elected Parliament ultimately needs to make decisions on targets. So I think the wording is better at stage 3. I'm happy to accept that as well.
Thank you. And I call Monica Lennon to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 1.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary and to Matt Ruskell for their comments. Hopefully, colleagues in the Chamber now understand what happens at stage 2, and we've got to a better place. I won't add anything to that, honestly, that I'll press Amendment 1.
Thank you. And the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 1, Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And we move to Group 2, Setting Scottish Carbon Budgets Explanatory Statement. And I call Amendment 3 in the name of Graeme Simpson, grouped with Amendment 4. Graeme Simpson to move Amendment 3 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've got one amendment here. It's a very simple amendment. It takes out one word. That word is broadly. Currently, the bill reads, a statement under subsection 5 must also set out in broadly indicative terms the proposals and policies in relation to each of the sectors mentioned, and then it goes on a bit. This was as a result of an amendment that I tabled at stage 2. I felt, and others felt, that phrase broadly indicative was rather woolly, so the happy compromise that I've reached with the Cabinet Secretary is to take out the word broadly, and broadly, that's where I'll leave it.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. I call Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 4 and the other amendment in the group.
Yeah, thanks very much, Presiding Officer. So happy to speak to Amendment 4. Amendment 4 requires ministers to indicate within which carbon budget period Scotland will achieve a 75% and a 90% cut in emissions. Now, you know, members will be aware that these were the figures, the percentage cut in emissions that were attached to the 2030 and 2040 targets. They exist in our climate legislation. So this bill does remove those targets and replace them with a mechanism to set carbon budgets. Members also recognise that there was considerable dismay this year when the government finally admitted that the 75% by 2030 target was beyond reach. So this is a moment when these targets are being removed from legislation, but I am pleased to have worked with the Cabinet Secretary to ensure that within the climate plans that will be coming forward, that effectively there will be public transparency. So we will be able to see when Scotland will meet 75%. We'll be able to see when we get three quarters of the way to net zero, and we will be able to see what the target date is effectively for meeting 90%. Reduction in emissions as well. So I think this is important for public transparency. It's not about setting up a shadow set of targets to run alongside the budgets, but it is important that public and stakeholders can see how far on track or off track we were for those original and very important targets that were set. Finally, can I say I welcome Amendment 3. I think it does tighten up the language that Graeme Simpson moved at stage 2, and it will ensure that we get more detail of the policies that the government intends to bring forward whenever the draft carbon budget is presented to Parliament.
Thank you. Call the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll be very brief because I'm pleased to have worked with Graeme Simpson and Mark Ruskell on both the amendments in this group, and I'll be supporting Amendments 3 and 4, and I would encourage others to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Monica Lennon.
Thank you. And in that spirit of consensus, I can advise that Scottish Labour will also support Amendments 3 and 4. Graeme Simpson was uncharacteristically woolly at Stage 2, but glad that's been sorted out. And just to agree with Mark Ruskell in terms of Amendment 4, we strongly agree that this will provide a useful yardstick in future to monitor how well we're doing in terms of reducing carbon emissions. And for that key reason, that it's really important that the public have that understanding, and it just creates that improvement in transparency.
Can I just ask if the Cabinet Secretary would like to respond to Ms Lennon's comments?
No, I don't really have any more to say in that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I call Graeme Simpson to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 3.
I'll press Amendment 3, and seeing as everybody seems happy, I'm happy to leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Simpson. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 4 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 3. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
I'm moved.
The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 5 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 1. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you, Mr Ruskell. We then move on to Group 3, anticipating and responding to failures and anticipated failures to meet emissions reduction targets. I call Amendment 6 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, grouped with Amendments 11 and 12. Douglas Lumsden, to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like Monica Lennon with her Amendment 1, I find myself in a position where I actually got a win in Stage 2 and got some amendments in, and then find myself in Stage 3 on picking some of that. What my amendments in Stage 2 were looking to do was to try and put a timetable in place for both the committee and the Parliament. But on discussions we had with the Cabinet Secretary, we felt that this was actually tie-in, not the government's hands, but Parliament's hands instead. So we looked at a better way of doing it, and I'm happy to have worked with the Cabinet Secretary to put forward amendments 6 and 12 that actually work together. The other amendment on this group from Mark Ruskell, Amendment 11, I think the word in there, the changes to the word in there adds to the bill, and happy to support that as well. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Can I just confirm, Mr Lumsden, that you're moving your amendment?
I wish to move, yes.
Thank you. I call Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 11 and other amendments in the group.
Yeah, thanks, Presiding Officer. So Amendment 11 seeks to tighten up the language from an amendment from Maurice Golden that was passed by committee at Stage 2. That amendment required ministers to set out their response to failing to meet a carbon budget. And I agree that this is needed, and while I sought to make a similar change at Stage 2 to a different part of the Act, I do accept the Government's preference for achieving this through Section 35B reports. I think there's a strong logic behind that. So my amendment adds to the text from Maurice Golden that was accepted. It adds that ministers' reports must set out the policy changes that will be made in response to a carbon budget not being met. And this will ensure that ministers set out more detail about how they respond and the changes that will be implemented using the most up-to-date data on Scotland's emissions reductions. So I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for constructive discussions on this issue. I think this improves the bill's transparency and will improve committee scrutiny and public awareness going forwards.
Thank you. And I call the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. So the Scottish Government supports all three amendments in this group. Amendments 6 and 12 from Douglas Lumsden, as he said, revisit the effect of two of his amendments at Stage 2. Grateful for him to be open and willing to work with me to do that. Entirely appreciate the intention around his Stage 2 amendments to ensure that Parliament promptly and properly scrutinises emissions reports. But as I did say at Stage 2, I don't think it's right to effectively involve the courts in policing how Parliament undertakes scrutiny and allocates its time. So Amendments 6 and 12 fix that issue. I'm supportive of Amendment 12, which will place a duty on government to seek to make a statement in Parliament about an emissions report. or to send copies of those reports directly to relevant committee conveners. And Mark Ruskell's Amendment 11 would strengthen the provision that I worked with Moz Golden to develop in Stage 2, adding another level of detail to reports under Section 35B of the 2009 Act, which I feel will be beneficial. So as such, I'm happy to support all Amendments 6, 11 and 12, and I urge all members to do the same.
I call Monica Lennon.
Thank you. Scottish Labour will also support Amendments 6, 11 and 12. These align with our aims to increase parliamentary oversight and to improve transparency and, as Mark Ruskell mentioned, to get that extra detail that we felt was perhaps going to be lacking. So we will support the amendments.
Thank you. Can I just confirm if the Cabinet Secretary would like to respond? Thank you. I call Douglas Lumsden to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 6.
Nothing more to add than press Amendment 6, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Lumsden. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We move on to Group 4, Climate Change Plan, Deadline and Procedure. I call Amendment 7 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 8, 9 and 10. I call the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 7 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The amendments in this group are focused on the procedure for producing climate change plans, and I would particularly like to thank Labour and Green NMSPs for their collaborative approaches to the development of these amendments. Amendment 7, in my name, fixes an error in an amendment that I worked with Sarah Boyack on in Stage 2. I apologise again to Ms Boyack for that error. Very grateful for cooperation and working with me to fix it. Mrs Boyack can't be here today, so I'm lodging this correcting amendment. The correction is simply so that the deadline for producing a draft of the first climate change plan is 2 months from the setting of Scottish carbon budgets, rather than that being the deadline for the final version of the plan, which would not be possible because of the length of the scrutiny period that the law requires in relation to the draft plan. I've also taken the opportunity with this amendment to firm up the deadline for the final version of the first climate change plan so that it has to be laid before Parliament within a fixed period from the end of the scrutiny period in relation to the draft plan. The fixed period is 90 days, but half have to be the days that Parliament is not in recess or is dissolved. Amendments 9 and 10 in my name are minor technical amendments that I mentioned at Stage 2 that I would be bringing forward to tidy up some of the provisions added by amendments from Mark Ruskell, which I supported. Amendment 9 simply removes words cross-referred to in Section 9, subsection 1D of the 2009 Act in a way that risks creating ambiguity about whether the extra consultative step would need to be taken if the timings did not quite line up correctly with the process described in that section. The Government is clear that the additional steps should be taken in those cases, and removing the words at the start makes that clear. Amendment 10 is another minor fix to tidy up grammatical errors, and I'm happy to support Amendment 8 from Mark Ruskell. The Government would, of course, be consulting on its policies and proposals for the climate change plan anyway, so I'm content with that being formalised, and I urge colleagues across the Chamber to support all amendments in this group, and I move Amendment 7.
Thank you. And I call Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 8 and other amendments in the group.
Yeah, thanks very much. Happy to speak to Amendment 8, which requires ministers to set out in a statement to Parliament their plans for holding public consultations on future climate change plans. Now, I did bring a similar amendment to Stage 2. Thank the Cabinet Secretary for continuing that discussion ahead of Stage 3. It's absolutely clear that the Government must lead a national conversation on the transition we need to make as a society. And we also need to respond to public concerns and accept the public's challenge to go further. Clearly, there's been a range of approaches that have been tried here, deliberative democratic approaches, citizens' panels, assemblies. But ultimately, it would be for the Scottish Government to decide how it wishes to engage the public on some very tricky and difficult and challenging decisions that are going to need to be made. And it's important that we get a social licence from the public as well to make those changes. So involving people directly in those conversations is really important as early as possible.
Thank you. I call Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for her comments in relation to my colleague Sarah Boyack. I know we had good discussions last week, and Sarah Boyack did appreciate the Cabinet Secretary's willingness to sort of fix out some of the oversights at stage two. So that's good to have that sorted. I think in terms of Mark Ruskell's Amendment 10, which we're supporting, in fact, we're supporting all the amendments in the group, but we did have a good discussion at stage two on the intention behind Mark Ruskell's amendment last week. It was only a week ago, stage two. So we understood and supported the principle of that. But I think this amendment gets the right balance. And I think an opportunity to just again remind the Chamber that the Net Zero Energy Transport Committee has heard from the People's Panel on Climate Change very strongly that the public want to be involved, want to be consulted and want that to happen in a very dynamic way. And there's obviously a raft of recommendations sitting with the government, but not just for government to reflect on, other public bodies too. So we think that this amendment is important and anything that reminds us that we do need to be on that journey and take the public with us and get the best of ideas from as many people in Scotland as possible can only be a good thing. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary to wind up.
I don't have anything else to say.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question then is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 8 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 7. Mark Ruskell to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 7. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 7. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 11 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 6. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 12 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, already debated with Amendment 6. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. We move on to Group 5, assessing the impact of major capital projects. And I call Amendment 13 in the name of Patrick Harvey in a group on its own. Patrick Harvey to move and speak to Amendment 13.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I brought an amendment at stage two on the issue of the emissions impact of major capital projects, and I explored a number of different ways in which that issue could be fitted into the new legislative framework, whether it should align with the carbon budget report, with the climate action plan, with various different points in the cycle. And I think the point was understood and accepted that there needs to be some way of ensuring that the government reports on an assessment of the impact of major capital projects, some of which, of course, Greens will disagree with others in the chamber. There'll be major capital projects which others make the case are compatible with our climate ambitions, but which Greens criticise. We can only really have that debate in an informed way. I'll give away in just a moment. We can only really have that debate in an informed way if those projects are properly and rigorously assessed and we have the information available to us in order to make those judgments. I give way.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank Patrick Harvey for taking the intervention. A couple of sort of points I was really looking for some clarification on. He talks about a major capital project. When would a capital project become a major capital project? Is there a definition already in place? And are we talking about capital projects that are owned by the government, or would this include the private sector as well?
Patrick Harvey.
Well, I was going to come on in a moment to talk about the specific framing of the new amendment, the changes from stage two, but I'll address those points now. I have worked with the government and listened to their responses to the arguments that I put at stage two, and they've suggested a form of words for this amendment, including saying that the impact of major capital projects, Mr. Lumsden will see, brackets as defined in the plan. So it's the plan itself which will define what are considered major capital projects, and it will be for the government to make that assessment. That plan, of course, has to be presented to Parliament, so Parliament will have its scrutiny of the judgments that have been made by the government in reaching that definition. The last point I wanted to make is that we have, of course, at the moment, a clear example of this gap of information. We know that a climate compatibility assessment has been conducted of a major transport project which the government continues to promote and which Greens continue to criticise, the A96 dualling. That report, that assessment, is with ministers. It hasn't been published. How on earth are we to be able to make judgments in an informed basis about future capital projects and their compatibility with future climate plans in the absence of that assessment? So I'm grateful that the government has seen fit to support an amendment to fill this gap. I hope it will have the support of the Chamber, and I move Amendment 13.
Thank you, Colm. Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At stage two, we were just a little bit unsure about the wording of Patrick Harvey's proposal. So we do appreciate the further work that's happened since last week. For that reason, we are content to support the amendment today. I think it's a fair question from Douglas Lumsden. It's one that we had also, but I think the wording of the amendment is reasonable. We know there'll be proposals that will come forward in the plan, but I think the principle behind it is welcome, and we can support it.
Thank you. And Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was just going to talk briefly. This is not an amendment I feel that we can support. There's still, a little wooliness around it in terms of what may be a capital project in the future. Still not clear whether it includes the private sector always. And also heard reference to the A96, and I guess that's one of my fears relating to this amendment, that it may be used in the future to stop projects like the A96 and the A9 going ahead. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So I was pleased to work with Patrick Harvey on this amendment, and I support its requirement that the Scottish Government needs to set out in our climate change plan the sort of definition of major capital projects and how they're going to be treated. I think that's given Parliament more information, and I think that's the right thing to do. Our reports under Section 33 at the end of each carbon budget period will require details of assessments carried out on that basis during the budget period covered by the report.
Thank you. And I call Patrick Harvey to wind up and press the withdrawal amendment 13. Mr Harvey.
No additional comments. I press the amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Harvey. The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No. Yes.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and as this is the first division of the stage, I suspend for around 5 minutes to allow members to access the digital voting system.